To assess hemostasis, we use six values. They are divided into two groups based on which stage of hemostasis they assess. To explain the logic behind these methods, we have briefly recalled the major steps in hemostasis. So, if damage to endothelial cell occurs, endothelin that was contained inside the endothelial cell will be released into the bloodstream and will cause transient vasoconstriction. After vasoconstriction, organism has to immediately cover and repair the damaged area. In order to do this, endothelial cells release from viable polarity bodies huge amount of 1-villibrin factor. In the bloodstream, 1-villibrin factor binds to subendothelial collagen under the disrupted endothelial cell. After that, platelets come to the site of injury, and by the specific receptor GP1B, they bind to 1-villibrin factor. And exactly this simple step called platelets adhesion. After the adhesion, platelets become activated. In response to this, they undergo shape change that results in their degranulation. With degranulation, platelets release the content inside them, including the dense granules that contain ADP. ADP that is released into the blood acts on the ADP receptor on platelets and activates it. Activation of ADP receptor forces platelets to transport GP2B3A receptor to the surface, where GP2B3A serves as binding site for fibrinogen. In addition to this, platelets from prostaglandins by COX enzyme begin to produce thromboxane A2, and the function of thromboxane A2 is to promote aggregation. When fibrinogen notice a GP2B3A receptor on platelet surface, fibrinogen immediately binds to GP2B3A, and when another platelet comes to the site of injury, platelet immediately binds by GP2B3A to fibrinogen. And this process is significantly accelerated by thromboxane A2. This binding occurs over and over again until platelet plaque will be formed. And exactly this gathering of platelets at the site of injury called aggregation. And aggregation results in formation of a platelet plaque. So up until this point is primary hemostasis. To assess the primary hemostasis, we use three values. They can be divided into two groups. The first group provides assessment of so-called quantitative platelet abnormalities and its total platelet count. Basically, we assess the quantity of platelets in the bloodstream, because without sufficient amount of platelets, platelet plaque and thereby thrombus cannot be formed. The second group assess qualitative platelet abnormalities. The logic here is that there is a possibility that the total amount of platelets can be normal. But due to some reason, for example due to deficiency of GP1B receptor in Bernard-Soulier syndrome, platelets cannot bind to 1-villibrin factor, and thereby they cannot form a platelet plaque. So even with normal quantity of platelets, primary hemostasis will be disrupted. The first value is bleeding time. Basically, we create the site of bleeding and then timing the cessation of bleeding. This test can be performed by two methods, its IV method and Duke method. For IV method, bleeding has to stop in 8 minutes, for Duke method in 3 minutes. Anything longer than that considered abnormal. In some countries, this method considered barbaric. As an alternative option, they have a more civilized method as platelet function assay. But as a matter of fact, they both provide assessment of qualitative platelet abnormalities. But platelet plaque is weak, and to stabilize it, to make it formidable, we have secondary hemostasis. The function of the secondary hemostasis is to make from weak platelet plaque a formidable structure that's called thrombus. And the thing that makes this platelet plaque formidable is conversion of unstable fibrinogen into a stable fibrin. Secondary hemostasis is provided by coagulation factors that form coagulation cascade. The central factor of coagulation cascade is factor 10. The goal of both intrinsic and extrinsic coagulation pathways is to activate factor 10. Intrinsic pathway consists of factors from 12 to 8. Extrinsic pathway consists of just factor 7. Activation of factor 10 results in activation of factors 5, 2 and 1. Factor 2 called prothrombin that with activation becomes thrombin, and factor 1 called fibrinogen that with activation becomes fibrin, and exactly fibrin makes from weak platelet plaque a formidable thrombus. So secondary hemostasis converts platelet plaque into a thrombus. For assessment of the secondary hemostasis, we use three methods. Prothrombin time is used to measure the function of the extrinsic pathway. The logic behind this is that in this test we add to a patient's blood a thromboplastin, which is a mixture of tissue factor, calcium and phospholipids. The major component is a tissue factor, because tissue factor activates factor 7 and thereby induces extrinsic coagulation pathway that activates factor 10 and eventually this results in production of a fibrin. So prothrombin time measures extrinsic and common coagulation pathway. The normal values of PT is 11-13. The problem with PT is that currently we have a lot of different preparations of thromboplastin reagents, which can give different PT results even when using the same plasma. Due to this variability, the international normalized ratio was created. And currently, exactly international normalized ratio is the new standard to measure extrinsic coagulation pathway. The international normalized ratio is basically the PT value that was measured in patient divided on a PT control, which is the value specific for every reagent. Basically, by this we remove the error that was caused by a reagent. So international normalized ratio is basically PT value without the error that was caused by a difference in reagents. So normal value of international normalized ratio is 1.0. The higher is the international normalized ratio, the lower is the activity of extrinsic pathway, thereby the lower is the coagulation. Both PT and international normalized ratio used in clinical practice to monitor the effect of warfarin. It's easy to remember because in PT there are two letters and the initial letter in warfarin is W. The activity of intrinsic pathway we measure by partial thromboplastin time. The mechanism here is that we add to patient's blood activating substances. The major substance is kaolin that we use to activate factor 12. And activation of factor 12 triggers intrinsic coagulation pathway that eventually activates factor 10. And activation of factor 10 results in formation of a fibrin. So partial thromboplastin time assesses intrinsic pathway and the common pathway. The normal value of partial thromboplastin time is 25 to 35 seconds. Basically, it's a time that is required for patient's blood to form a clot. So the longer is the time, the lower is the coagulation. PTT is commonly used in clinical practice to monitor the effect of heparin. It's also easy to remember because in PTT there are three letters and the abbreviation of heparin is HEP. So as we see, PTT is more specific for intrinsic pathway, PT and INRI for extrinsic pathway. If you like content, please press like and subscribe button. All the best!